Well, good morning. Are we ready to worship an awesome God? Okay, I heard three amens. I'm ready to. We thank you for joining us today here in the service. And thank you, folks, for being online and being so faithful, watching us from there. And we worship together. It's not just we're up here singing and you guys follow along. We're all worshiping. We hope you're worshiping at home and singing along with us. Let's just stand and let's pray praise Him together. Holy, holy, holy. Let's sing together. Talking this morning about the Trinity. How can there be three in one? Well, I said, you have a pie and you divide it in thirds and it's still one pie. You can take any one of those pieces of the pie out, it's still part of that pie. And somebody jokingly said, so you're going to eat a third of a pie? No, I'm not going there. I'm just making an observation, all right? But that's the Trinity. God is in three persons. One person God, three personalities of God. All right? Let's sing the second verse.
His love endures forever.
Thinking about this song this week, and it brought to memory this musical that was written many, many years ago called God's Trombones. And one of the sections of that musical is called The Creation. And it's really set where a preacher is preaching about creation. And the choir is singing, amen, amen, come on, preacher, give it to us, you know, that kind of thing. And the very first line was, and God stepped out in space. And from nothing, he threw the earth into existence. From nothing. He threw the sky into existence. From nothing. God, the creator. God was here before anything began. And that's who we're singing about today. God, his power, his strength, his love. We praise him for that. Let's sing this last verse.
Crucified, laid behind the stone.
Together. Lord, help us to never in our minds and our hearts put you in a box and say, this is what you do. This is who you are. We can never describe all that you are, all that you do, all your power, all your strength, all your creation. It's all you. We can't describe that. You're so much bigger, so much stronger. But yet, you love each one of us. You know each one of us. You take care of each one of us as your children. Help us, Lord, to turn our lives to you and let you be our God, our Lord, our provider. Bless the one who is to speak today. Give him your strength and your grace, your courage to say the words that are really on his heart today. And help us to listen and not just take it all in, but to do something about it. That's why we're here today. We give it to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Be seated.
Well, good morning. We're glad each one of you guys are here, and I am glad to be with you. As lots of you know, Ethel and I have been in Peru, and we were leading a conference of pastors, about 30 pastors that we had there in Cusco, Peru, and doing a New Testament course. So it was great to be there. It was a very warm 40 degrees every morning, and so it seems a little hot in this country to me at this point. But we are glad to be back, and we are glad that you're with us today. And I want to call your attention to the connection card that you have there in your worship folder. And on that connection card, you can fill that connection card out. You have two choices there. Let us know a little bit about yourself. You can share a prayer request. You can let us know about any commitment, spiritual commitment that you feel like that you want to make today and share with us. And then also, you can scan that QR code on the other side of that card, and that'll take you to our webpage. And then you have kind of a little bit expanded version where you can let us know about some different things we can pray for you about there also, or any other things you're interested in or would like to find out about, that sort of thing. That's all available to you through that connection card. We're really pleased today. I'm really glad for you guys that we get to have David Fresh with us today. David happens to be in the country. He is the pastor of North Sea Baptist Church in Stavanger, Norway. Some of you remember that I spent some time there at Stavanger kind of filling in for David while he was gone, and he and I have got to be good friends, and it's great to have him. He was in Houston, so invited him to come up and speak today, so we're excited that he and his wife, Scotty, are with us, and you guys are going to be blessed today as we begin this brand new series called One Hit Wonders. Now, David is pastor of North Sea Baptist Church, also gives leadership to several global missions ministries. If you guys would know, and some things we have connected with here at Crestview with David about was some water wells as well as some chicken coops that we purchased through our December offering in Malawi, Africa. And so David was the one who was the point person for us about that, and also we've had some support given that we have given as a church to a ministry in Vietnam, and I think he's going to tell you a little bit about some of that a little bit more today in the message. And so we're so excited to have David with us today. And so as we begin this brand new series, this series is going to be looking at some of the shorter books in the Bible and just look at some of the great message that God has for us through those books of the Bible. So I want to encourage you to take your Bibles, your mobile device, get to the book of Haggai. That's where we're going to be today. And David's going to be leading that in just a moment. And so we're so excited to have you guys here and have David with us also. And so get ready for looking at God's Word this morning.
Was quite the intro. Thank you, John, so much for the introduction. Appreciate it. It is so wonderful to be back with you all today. It's been about 3 years, I think, since I was with you last time, and it's a real pleasure and an honor and a privilege to be with you all. And for my wife and I, we're very blessed to know John and Alta Lynn and get to spend time with them. And I know you all know how blessed you are to have John here as a pastor. So thank you for letting me steal him a few years ago. If I can ever get him to Norway again, I'll steal him again, just so you know. So, but it is really a pleasure for us to be here. We do really appreciate the partnership. You all have helped us to literally save lives. In Malawi, there were children who were dying from starvation and from cholera and other issues, and we've got 6 villages we've worked in, And as John mentioned, you helped us to drill 3 more water wells. So we have 6 wells now, 1 in every village. It's eliminated cholera. We haven't had a child die from malnutrition or cholera in 3 or 4 years now since we got the first 3 wells dug. But this is just helping in so many ways. It's bringing the gospel. It's allowing people to be in church. There's so many things I could tell you if we had more time, but really do appreciate that partnership. At Christmas, we raised enough money for 3 wells and about 1.5 chicken coops. And I want to thank Jimmy's leadership and the senior adults. I know many of you are here today who recently donated money to help us finish the 2nd chicken coop, or what is the 6th chicken coop in those villages, but the 2nd from Crestview. So thank you so much for your generosity. Really appreciate that. It really means a lot. And all that money, 100%, goes to the work in Malawi. And we've sent it all on, and that work is happening now. I'm hoping to have John and maybe some others from the church come with me to Malawi, perhaps later this year or next year, so they can see the work firsthand. But today I want to talk to you about Haggai, as John mentioned. We're going to be doing a look at the book, and I'm going to go through the whole book. Now, we don't have time to read it all, so I encourage you to take time to read through this book later today or later this week, because after we've done the overview today, I think it'll be a lot easier to make sense of it, and I just encourage you to spend some time meditating on it this week. But we're going to pick through a few verses today and talk about those. But before we get into the actual book, if you would do me a favor, how many of you have smartphones? Okay, all right, most of you. If you don't have a smartphone, I don't know. It's time. It's time. But if you do, do me a favor and put it in your pocket or put it face down next to you. Just, I'm going to give it back to you. For some of you, this is going to be the hardest 3 minutes of your life. But just put it to the side. Now, while you're putting it down, I see David has taken a minute. So while you're putting it down, I'll tell you a story. Thank you for the music, by the way, brother. I appreciated that. My wife and I, we travel a lot, and so, you know, carrying books with you can be a little bit of a pain. My record one time, I took 43 books with me in a suitcase, and that's when I realized I needed to go digital. So I got Logos, which is a Bible program. My wife got a Kindle because she likes to read a lot of novels, and she got this Kindle some years ago, and she took it with her to bed. She took it with her to the beach, took it with her on the plane, and then she did something that was so egregious. I got up to preach in my church one Sunday. Now, you may not believe it, but we as pastors, we need some positive affirmation sometimes. And I always think my wife is supposed to give that to me. I'm still waiting. But so I get up to preach one Sunday, and my wife is a good pastor's wife. She takes a seat in the 2nd row. I mean, that's where really spiritual people sit. You have to be on staff to sit in the front row. I can see. Right, but like the next row, that's pretty spiritual. So my wife sits in the 2nd row, and I'm feeling pretty good, and I get up, and I organize my notes. And as I begin the sermon, we get to the scripture, my wife, she pulls her Kindle out, and she starts reading a book. And I'm just livid. I know we're not supposed to get angry as pastors, but I'm not as spiritual as John. So I'm just seeing red. And I can't even focus on my sermon anymore, and I'm trying to preach, but all I can think about is how dare she. She just keeps looking down at her Kindle, and I'm saying some really good stuff that I think she needs to hear. So the sermon, I finish the sermon, we finish the service, and I go do what good pastors do. I go to the back of the church, and I'm telling everybody, thank you for coming, so nice to see you, and I'm really not thinking that. I'm going, where is she? Where is she? And I find her after church, and I go, and I don't even make it home, and I say, and I try to be gracious. Like, how can I, like, not just say what I'm really feeling, which is just how, you know, how dare you? So I said, honey, if you're going to read a novel in church, could you at least sit in the back? And she looked at me, and she goes, what are you talking about? I said, your Kindle. She goes, I have a Bible on here. I didn't know you could have Bibles on the Kindle. I felt pretty terrible. And then my stomach churned, I thought something else. I thought, what did I just preach on? Because I hadn't been thinking about the sermon. All I could think about was her there in the 2nd row. And the reason I share that story with you today is because as we look at Haggai and we talk about this, the theme, the title today is Never Enough. The idea is that as the Israelites worked for their own good, they got distracted from what God wanted for them. And very often, all the devil needs to do is distract God's people from our mission, and he's got to win. Sure, he would love us to fall into terrible sin and walk away from God completely, but you know what? If he can keep the church distracted from doing their mission, then the rest of the world can go to hell in a handbasket. And that morning, God had an assignment for me, and I got distracted. And I still pulled off the sermon, but I was distracted. And it shouldn't matter what anybody else is doing around me. My focus should be what God has called me to do. And yet, it's so easy for us to get distracted from that. And in the case of the Israelites and Haggai, they're distracted from what God has put before them. Now, as you put your phones to the side, here's why. I want you to think in your mind, what is the bottom right icon on your front screen? So if you've got a picture of the phone up here, so not the taskbar at the bottom, but what is the bottom right? Just think for a second. Do you have it? On your own phone, what's the bottom right? Now, take your phone out, look real quick, and put it back down. All right? Now, how many of you were correct? Raise your hands. Three. Four. Okay, now, when you pulled your phone out, right in front of you was a clock. How many of you noticed what time it was when you looked at the phone? Three of you. All of you leave now. You're not listening close enough. No, in all seriousness, it's right there in front of our faces. How often, you know how many times I've pulled my phone out to check something, put it away and gone, what time is it? And pulled it right back out. Why? I had you distracted. I had you looking for some little detail and you missed the thing that was right in front of your face. And that's what's happening with the Israelites today as we come to the book of Haggai. They are distracted from what's right in front of their face and what God wants them to do. So let's pray and then we're going to look at this book. God, we thank you for Haggai. We thank you for the words that we're going to look at today. We thank you for the truth that's found here. And we just pray, Father, that you would help us to not be like the Israelites at the beginning of the book, but for us to be focused on your calling on our lives. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Just a real quick before we get into the text, I want to give you a timeline. In case you don't know where Haggai falls, we've got a timeline here. You can see the fall of Jerusalem was in 586 B.C., and then we've got Persia's conquest of Babylon. So this was the top one is where Daniel was taken into captivity. And you got Daniel's story. And then down in 520, we have the ministries of Haggai and Zechariah. You can see in 516, the temple is restored. So this is before, the book starts before the temple has been restored. That is what God is calling the people to rebuild his house, the temple. Then they've not been paying attention to this. So let's read out of Haggai chapter 1. In verse 9 we read, "You looked for much, and behold, it came to little. And when you brought it home, I blew it away. Why, declares the Lord of hosts? Because of my house that lies in ruins, while each of you busies himself with his own house." So he says, the things you're doing have come to ruin. They haven't actually amounted to what you thought they would because you've ignored my house. They've been focused on their own comfort. They've been focused on fixing up their houses and their land. And they found that it's never enough. They never quite have enough time for God because there's always one more thing for them to do for their own comfort. If we go and look back a few verses at verse 6, we read, "You have sown much and harvested little. You eat, but you never have enough. You drink, but you never have your fill. You clothe yourselves, but no one is warm. And he who earns wages does so to put them into a bag with holes." I love this illustration, the idea that you're collecting money. Imagine collecting coins. And you're collecting coins in a bag, and as you're going to collect the money, as you go home, it's all falling out. And the idea here is, it never feels like they have enough. Now, maybe you feel this way. You put money in your bank account and it falls out. That's called a credit card or a spouse. I can say that because my wife's not here yet. But the point is that they had this feeling that we're working hard, we're sowing, but we're never reaping enough. And the problem is that they're not putting God first. And God says, look, it's not that you're not working hard enough. It's that you've got your priorities out of order, and so I'm not allowing you to be blessed. I'm not blessing the work you're doing. And so the big idea we get out of Haggai is that the Israelites are putting themselves ahead of God. They're putting themselves first instead of putting God first. And no matter what they do, it's never enough. You see, ever since creation, we've been living with a curse. Well, ever since, not creation, as we were saying about when God created, it was perfect. But ever since the fall, Genesis chapter 3, and the curse severed three relationships. It hurt three relationships. It hurt our relationship with God. It hurt our relationships with each other. And it hurt our relationship with creation. Creation was cursed. God says you're going to have to work by the sweat of your brow. It's going to be difficult. So these people, they're working very hard, but they're still under a curse. Now, Jesus Christ, he has victory over the curse, but many times we still choose to live under the curse. And what they're doing here is, instead of putting God first and allowing him to give them victory over this, they're continuing to try their hardest to work as hard as they can, and it's never enough. It's like they're hitting a glass ceiling. You know this idea of a glass ceiling, that they can see the next level they want to go to. It's right there, but they can't quite make it. I think we've got a picture of this too. Just this idea that you see above you. They see that we ought to reap more crops. We ought to have more money, but somehow we're just not making it. What is holding us back? And God says, I'm holding you back. He says that very clearly in verse 9. He's the one holding them back. Now, what's really interesting, if you go and read Deuteronomy chapter 28, we're not going to do it right now, but here's some references if you want to look into it later. I encourage you to. You'll see some of the wording in Deuteronomy. God has said ahead of time, this is what will happen if you don't put me first. And it's exactly what they're experiencing in Haggai. It was prophesied to them. So this is not something that they should have been confused about. God had given them fair warning. As a matter of fact, Haggai harkens back to the books of Moses, to the first five books of the Bible, in the vocabulary it uses. It's very clear it's looking back to Deuteronomy here. And so God had warned them in the beginning, I will bless you if you honor me, and if you don't honor me, it's going to be tough. And that's what they're experiencing. And yet they continue to try the same things over and over again. They continue to collect money with a bag with holes instead of patching the bag up, instead of figuring out what's really going on. We read also here in Haggai chapter 1, where we read verse 9 already here. But you looked for much, and behold, it came to little. And when you brought it home, I blew it away. And he says again, why, declares the Lord of hosts? Because of my house that lies in ruins. So this brings us to our first point in your notes, which is that sacrifice matters in our relationship with God. God cares about us making a sacrifice. Why? Is God lacking? Is there anything that God does not have? Does he need your money, your time, your talents? No. But God cares because it's how we express our faith in him. When we give to him, whether it's treasure, time, talents, whatever God calls you to give, it shows that we trust him for our provision. If we say, well, God, not yet. I need to fix this, and I got to do this, and I've got to do this, and then I'll give to you, God. What does that say? We're relying on ourselves. That I think it's up to me to fix everything. But if we're willing to give to God first, whatever he calls us to, that shows that, you know what, God, I believe you're going to make sure all this other stuff works out. And that's what he desires, is a life of faith. But they're not doing that. They're saying, oh, I've got to do one more thing. I've had people tell me, well, I'm not giving any money to the church right now because I've just got to get some other things fixed, and then I'll do that. I've got to pay off some other bills. And you know what? It just never seems to happen. Because there's never a convenient time to sacrifice. Sacrifice has to come first, and then God helps us get everything in order in our lives. That's what the Israelites needed to get their heads around. The problem is people think, well, give me a little more time and I'll get there. As John mentioned, I lead a network of international churches around the world. I was in Montevideo, Uruguay earlier this year, and my friend John Hamilton is a pastor there, and he was preaching, and he said a great line. He said, time doesn't bring change. Change brings change. And the idea is we have to make the decision. If you're like the Israelites and you have not been heeding God's voice, you've not been sacrificing, you've not been doing what is his plan for your life, you've been saying, wait, God, I'll get to you later, more time isn't going to fix it. We have to make the effort of saying, you know what, it stops today. today I'm going to put God first. Because of that, that day is never going to come on its own. Yes, the Holy Spirit is in us and working for as the author and perfecter of our faith, but we're also told we have to work out our salvation with fear and trembling. We are partnering with God, and if we quench the Spirit, if we are not doing our part and we're ignoring God, we're not going to enjoy the full life that He has for you. As we move on in Haggai, we read here, then Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, and Joshua, the son of Jehozadak, the high priest, with all the remnant of the people, obeyed the voice of the Lord their God. So finally, they're going to do what he said. And the words of Haggai the prophet, as the Lord their God had sent him, and the people feared the Lord. Then Haggai, the messenger of the Lord, spoke to the people with the Lord's message. I am with you, declares the Lord. You see, now that they're sacrificing, now that they're putting God first, he'll be with them. God responds to us. God responds to our prayers. He responds to our acts of faith. He responds as we walk with him. It's frightening at times, but it's the call that he has in our lives. So they had been trying the same thing over and over again. You've probably heard the definition of insanity, right? Doing the same thing over and over again, expecting different results. We think it was actually Einstein who said that quote. Another way of putting it, I love this quote, is by Abba Eben. He was a representative from Israel to the United Nations. And he said, history teaches us that men and nations behave wisely once they have exhausted all other alternatives. Now, that's pretty true on a number of levels, isn't it? But the sad thing is, as much as you might want to look at the nations and go, yeah, and look at the politicians and say, yeah, we look at our own lives. And sometimes we do the same thing. We don't act wisely until we've exhausted every other option. And God's saying, stop. Stop doing the same things over and over that aren't working for you. Put me first, even though it's counterintuitive. Oh, I don't have the time, the money, the energy to put God first. But put God first and all the other stuff works itself out. Jesus reflects this in the New Testament when he says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and all these things will be added unto you. It's the same idea. It's the same idea from the beginning of time. Adam and Eve, if they'd put God first, everything would have worked a lot better. But instead, they put themselves first, and look where it got us. So it's a message of the Bible from Genesis to Revelation, which is, who are you putting first? Who is on the throne of your life? Romans 12 says, offer yourselves as a living sacrifice. Now, I don't know how many of you have ever sacrificed an animal. Probably none of us. Some of you may have slaughtered an animal. But if you put an animal on an altar and it's still alive, what's the problem? It's going to get up and run away. And yet Romans tells us to offer ourselves as living sacrifices. We don't slaughter ourselves, but we willingly get on the altar. And you know what? It's really easy the next day to get back up. So it's a constant daily surrendering of our will, our desires to God. But when we do that, he's the one that then puts our lives in order, and it ends up so much better than we could have ever done it ourselves. Look throughout the scriptures. Look at how many times people try to do it themselves and how that works. So we want to do whatever God has for us. Christians and churches are best when we are on mission with whatever God has as an agenda for you. And what that is for you is different than for me or for John. We all have a different calling from God. Your church is a special calling. It's different than my church. And that can be overwhelming at times. Because there's so much need in the world. There's so many opportunities for us to serve God. And sometimes it can feel overwhelming. It reminds me of the movie The Lion King, where there's the song, there's more to see than can ever be seen and more to do than can ever be done. And that's true. But God doesn't call you to do all of it. He simply calls you to walk in faith in whatever he's called you to. And that can be frightening. Because when we're really walking by faith, we have to step up to into the Jordan before we see the waters part. And it's scary for me, too. I'm not saying I have it perfectly. Earlier this year, God, I can't tell you the whole story now. I wish I could, but I'll have to tell it to you briefly. But God opened the doors for me to go down to a little country in Africa called Lesotho. Now, you may never have heard of it. Lesotho is inside of South Africa. So it's a tiny little country completely bordered by South Africa. So you have to fly to South Africa and then drive in to Lesotho. It's a mountainous kingdom. And God opened the doors for me to go there and have some meetings with the prime minister, the deputy prime minister, and so forth. And it's a really cool thing where God is giving us the opportunity to bring change to a nation from the top down. It's about 3 million people in the country, and we're getting access to from the very top, military leaders, political leaders, everything. And so God opened these doors, and yet part of me is thinking, who am I? It's like Moses going to Pharaoh, like, I'm from the wilderness, I'm from a little country in, you know, Norway. Who am I to go talk to kings and prime ministers? But I felt God calling me, and so I stepped up in faith, and I told my church I was going, and this is what God was calling me to. And then 2 weeks before I went, I got COVID. And my oldest daughter, who was going with me, also got COVID. And suddenly, my faith was shaken. I thought, well, God, I thought you were calling me, but now I'm not going to be able to go. And what you may not know is South Africa has a rule. If you test positive, it doesn't matter if it was 30 days, 60 days ago, you cannot enter the country. And they were telling me, you're going to test positive with a PCR test for weeks. And so my faith is shaken. I'm doing everything I can to figure out how to get in the country. I'm talking to the embassies, and I'm talking to political leaders. But I began to not talk about it to my church because I went, oh, this is embarrassing. How does this look for me as the pastor saying God's calling me, and then I end up stuck at home? What does that say about me not hearing God's voice? So here I am in my own strength beginning to doubt. And I sense God saying, just keep moving ahead in faith. And I'm going, but God, why'd you let me get COVID if you wanted me to go on in faith? So I'm just being honest with you. It's kind of embarrassing, but I was shaken. The day before we're supposed to leave town, God comes through in spades. I get a letter from the South African government giving me an exemption. I get a negative PCR test somehow, and I get the private phone number for the person who runs the Port Authority at Johannesburg Airport. So, like, suddenly there was no problem with me getting in the country. I had three different ways to get in. And I felt so bad about my lack of faith. Now, this is where it gets worse. This is just an embarrassing story. Don't tell anybody as you're streaming this around the world. So I go to Paris on my way to Johannesburg. And I get to Paris, and I'm sitting in the lounge, and I write a letter to my church. I do a weekly letter to my church. And I write a letter to my church, and I tell them the story with a little more detail than I've told you, but how my faith was shaken and how, you know, I repent from that because I see God was in control. He was calling me. And it's still scary. I mean, I don't know how many of you have had to sit down with a president or a prime minister, but it can be intimidating, especially when I'm not Bill Gates. I don't have loads of money or whatever. Again, I don't know how I'm supposed to do this, but God's called me, and look, he's opened the doors, and so I see how God is faithful, even though I was faithless. It was a great email. It was great. I felt really good about the email. I got some good responses, and I shut my computer. We leave the lounge, and we're heading to the flight, and I'm feeling really good. God, my faith is 100%. I will never be shaken again. I get in my seat, and my phone dings with a message. And it's the former Secretary of Health of Lesotho telling me, your meetings with the king and the prime minister, that they've all been canceled. And my first thought, I'm embarrassed to tell you, was, I wish I hadn't sent that email. Now, where was my faith? But right away, I'm like, oh, this is so embarrassing. How does this look on me? But I prayerfully, what am I going to do, get off the plane? I went ahead and went. And God opened doors in the most amazing ways. And we had our meetings, and we've got a meeting set up with the king and queen next year. I'm hoping to have Pastor John with me. And it was just so cool. If I could tell you the whole story of how he did it, it's miraculous. But the point was, it's been a real lesson for me that the devil would love for me to be distracted, whether it's by COVID, whether it's by people canceling meetings. But you know what? They don't control these things. God is in control. And so if we're following him, even when the waters are raging, when we step in the water, if he's told us to step forward, if he hasn't, don't do it. But if he's told you to, the waters will part. That's what happened for the Israelites crossing the Jordan. If he's told me to go to Lesotho, the meetings will happen. But it's scary sometimes. I'm with you. I get scared too. I have times where God continues to up the ante and call me to walk by faith in a new way that, as you've seen, I don't always do really well with it. But this is what we're called to do. And the great thing we see in the second point is when we engage in God's work, he engages in our lives. When we make that step of faith, we see all of God's power come with us. But when we're not willing to make that step of faith, we don't enjoy God's power and God's provision. Another way to say this is our response to God determines his response to us. Now, if we move on to chapter 2, there's only two chapters in this book. But in chapter 2, we read, "The silver is mine and the gold is mine, declares the Lord of hosts." Now, I love this part of the verse. We're going to go on, so leave it up, please. But because this is what God's saying. He has all that's needed. They're trying to build a temple. And they might have said, well, how are we going to make this temple nice? This is, if you read the book of Haggai, you'll see they're thinking, this doesn't look very nice. The old temple that Solomon built had gold and silver, and it was just amazing. But we're not Solomon. We don't have all the money and the treasure, and our temple's not going to look very good. And God says, what are you thinking? You don't have it, but all the gold, all the silver, it's mine. Same thing as when God's telling me, you don't have meetings set up. I control the political leaders. I control your schedule. And God's saying the same thing to you, that he has all the resources you need to carry out his will for you. Now, sometimes we're doing things that are good ideas, but they're not God ideas. And we go, why isn't God blessing this? Well, maybe you're doing something that's not what he called you to. But if you're doing what he called you to, he provides. We read on, the latter glory of this house shall be greater than the former, says the Lord of hosts. And in this place I will give peace, declares the Lord of hosts. So God says, it's going to be even better than before. Now, there's different ways to interpret this, but we know it's ultimately fulfilled in Jesus. Because Jesus stands in the temple and he says, tear down this temple, and in 3 days I'll raise it up again. The latter glory of the temple was far greater than the former glory, because Jesus Christ himself embodied the temple and was God incarnate here on earth. So we get our third point here. God's provision, not our output, determines the outcome. God's provision, not our output, determines the outcome. It reminds me of Psalm 127:1. You know this verse. Unless the Lord builds the house, those who labor build it in vain. Now, we hear this verse, we talk about this verse, because it means we need God to be a part of it. If we go back to Haggai for just a second, and we read in Haggai chapter 2:19, is the seed yet in the barn? Indeed, the vine, the fig tree, the pomegranate, and the olive tree have yielded nothing. But then God says, but from this day on, I will bless you. He says, you've been struggling and it's not been working out, but now that you are putting me first, now that they're laying the foundation for the temple, he says, I'm going to bless you from here on out. And that reminds me of the second verse of Psalm 127. We often look at the first verse. Do you know what the second verse says? I think that Americans need to hear this verse even more. It is in vain that you rise up early and go late to rest, eating the bread of anxious toil, for he gives to his beloved sleep. It is not sheep. We got to change that. If you look in your Bible, it's sleep. God gives his beloved sleep. You see, when we're doing what God calls us to do, it doesn't mean we have to run ourselves ragged. I find in America sometimes we seem to think that the more hours we work, the more spiritual we are. But the reality is, if we're doing what God wants us to do, there's a balance. We get the rest we need. God ordained rest. And so that's what he's called us to. And so if we're doing what God wants, it doesn't mean we do work hard for God's kingdom. But it doesn't mean we exhaust ourselves, because it doesn't depend on you. You do what God calls you to. He brings the power and need it, and you get your rest. It's a pretty good deal. And we see once they start honoring God, he blesses it, and suddenly they have they're reaping the crops. They've got the money not falling out of the holes. I want to close with a quote here by Paulo Coelho, who said, "The ship is safest when it is in port, but that's not what ships were built for." In some ways, the Israelites were trying to keep themselves safe. They were just focused on their own houses, their own property, and they weren't doing what God called them to. Same thing goes for us. Another way to say this quote is, the ship is most comfortable when it is in port, but that's not what ships were built for. God hasn't built you to just be comfortable. God has built you for a purpose that extends beyond time. There's an eternal purpose God has for each one of us. And it may be more comfortable to focus on all those distractions, all those other icons that are on the smartphone, but God doesn't want us distracted. He wants us focused on the mission he's put before you. Now, I don't know what that is for each one of you. But I would encourage you, I have two next steps today for you to pick from. One would be to take an inventory of where your time is going in life and what is motivating your actions and make sure you are seeking first His kingdom. That's a mouthful. But the idea is, where are you spending your time and what motivates you? There can be lots of good things you're doing. And I don't mean you have to be at church every day. But if we're going to soccer practice with the kids, that can be because it's a part of God's kingdom. I used to run a soccer league in my city, partially so my daughter could play soccer and nobody else would run it, but partially so I could meet non-Christians, because I don't meet a lot of them at church. I do meet some, but that's another story. And so I had that as an outreach. But the point is, what is motivating your actions for your time? Are you seeking first His kingdom in all that you're doing? Or here's another option. Prayerfully consider how your response to God is impacting God's response to you. Now just think about that. How is your response to God? Has He spoken to you? Is there something He's waiting on you to do and respond to Him? Because if so, we need to respond so that we can experience God's best for our lives. Thank you, John.
Have a time just to consider what God is saying to each of us today. David has taken us through two next steps there, and I'd like to just, I think there's been a great challenge, though, also from Haggai, from God's Word, about faith. Just about your own faith, your level of faith, and how much you're just depending upon God right now and willing to trust that He is going to be at work and you trust His process and what He has for you. So just want to give you some time right now just for you and God to have that conversation. You may want to pray. You may want to finish filling out that connection card. You may want to indicate any kind of spiritual commitment that you know that God wants you to make today. We have a baptism day coming up on the 24th, and for some of you, that may be your next step. But whatever it is that God has for you, we just want to take this time right now, and if you would, just bow your heads with me. And let's just have this time of silence that we just ask God to speak to each one of us right now. God, we thank You so much for Your Word that is practical to our lives, that gives us direction and helps us to realize how we need to seek You first. We thank You for how Your Word points us to that very important step in our lives. We pray that we would truly do that, that we would respond to You in faith as You would want us to. And God, it's so easy for us to doubt. Especially now, it just seems like it's easy to say, what's next, what's going to happen? But help us to realize that everything is in Your hands, that we can place our faith totally and completely in Your hands and realize that You are the one that we can trust with all of our life. And God, I pray You'd increase our faith, that You would help us to realize that is the response You want us to have to You. And so, Lord, we pray today that You would help each one of us to do that. And we thank You so much for Your Word that changes our lives. And all this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together. We're going to have a time of commitment. I'm going to be here at the front, and so let's sing together right now.
Be not dismayed, whatever time, God will take care of you. Beneath His wings of love abide, God will take care. Take care.
going to ask our ushers to come forward, and you have an opportunity right now to turn in that connection card. If you have indeed filled that card out, you can place that in the offering buckets as they're passed down your row. And again, we always thank you for your generosity. You are a very generous people, and we're grateful for how you are generous in so many different ways, and we're thankful for how God is generous also to us. Thank you, Kathy. We're so glad that you guys have been here today. We want to thank David for being with us today. And David, as one encouraging church member said to me one of the times after a sermon, I stayed awake most of the time. So it was a no. Appreciate so much you sharing from God's word and the blessing of that. And let me just share a couple things with you before we are dismissed. The first thing is, tonight, I think there's a ladies' paint night. We have a large group of ladies being part of that. I was not invited, but we are having that event tonight, and I hope you guys are going to participate in that. Then we have the family swim night that will be going on, and I wanted you guys to know about that. And then a very important day, on July the 24th, we're going to have our baptism day. And so we have several folks that are lined up to be baptized that day, and so I want to encourage you about that. If you have made that commitment. Also, next Sunday, we'll give you a little bit of a preview for our Four Midland missions emphasis here in the community. We help a lot of local schools get ready for school starting, some other different projects across the community. And so you're going to have an opportunity to participate in all those. You're going to hear about that next Sunday, and just want to let you guys know about that. It's been so great to have each one of you here and have David with us. We're glad that you are here. God bless you. You are dismissed.
Bless the song.